Well, as I've already mentioned, this evening we are returning to Psalm 84, and I would like to go ahead and read that as we begin to refresh our memories exactly what it says, and then we're going to, as I've said already, look at the second main point of this psalm, and that is how our love for the Lord will cause us to desire to draw near to Him. Psalm 84, beginning in verse 1, psalmist writes this: "How lovely are your dwelling places, O Lord of hosts! My soul longed and even yearned for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. The bird also has found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. How blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. How blessed is the man whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. Passing through the valley of Baca, they make it spring. The early rain also covers it with blessings. They go from strength to strength. Every one of them appears before God in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold our shield, O God, and look upon the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000 outside. I would rather stand at the threshold of the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord gives grace and glory. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, how blessed is the man who trusts in you." May the Lord bless his word to our hearing this evening. Now remember, this morning we saw the psalmist pronounce blessing on those whose strength is in the Lord. We just read that again in verse 5. Through Hebrew parallelism, he was telling us that this strength really amounts to a desire, to a love for God. If we have it, we're blessed, not only because if we have this kind of love, it shows that we really do know the Lord, because really only those who know Him love Him in this way, that we really do possess eternal life. This is the main way we can know that we have it, when we love God, but also because it gives us the strength that we need to serve Him. If we don't love the Lord, we might do some things that, again, are hypocritical. Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians 13 that it's possible to make great sacrifices without love. But we're never going to, as Christians, be able to give ourselves to the Lord in the way that He calls us to unless we love Him. Love Him most of all. Love has the unique ability to help us overcome every obstacle that stands in the way, in our way of serving Him. As Watson again reminded us this morning, love heaven, and you cannot miss it. Love breaks through all opposition. It takes heaven by storm. And of course, you know the only reason why Watson would say that we ought to love heaven is because God is there. He is what makes heaven to be heaven. Love God, and you cannot miss heaven. It will make you, give you the strength to break through everything that stands in the way and to be able to press on towards glory. If we want to be able to do what it is that the Lord calls us to do, we have to be spiritually strong. If we would be spiritually strong, we must love the Lord, as Jesus calls us to, with an undivided heart. And if we would love Him in this way, we do need to seek Him in the ways that He's given us to seek Him. As we were focusing on this morning, the Word of God and prayer, the Lord's Supper and fellowship. But don't forget, it's not just going through the motions. We actually have to be seeking the Lord through these things, but also through our obedience, by loving and serving our neighbor, and especially our brethren. We're going to focus a little bit more on that this evening, but just a little at the end. Now, as we continue to look at the psalm, there's something else about it that should pop out at us, and that is what the psalmist's love was moving him to do, to seek out that place where the Lord reveals himself. And I think that's quite clear in the psalm. Notice the desire that he expresses throughout the psalm to be near the Lord, particularly because of how lovely his dwelling places actually are in verse 1. And of course, things are only lovely if you desire them. If you hate them, they're not lovely. So he found God's dwelling places to be lovely. He expresses in verse 2 how his soul yearned for the Lord's courts, how when he was there, it made his heart and his flesh sing for joy. Now, this thing about the bird, you know, sounds a little bit strange, but I think what he's expressing here is basically his envy of the birds and of the sparrows that have made their home in the courts of the Lord, in the house of the Lord, because they were always in his presence. He expresses basically the same towards those who served in that place because they were privileged continually to stand before the Lord and to sing his praises. He considered that one day in the Lord's courts was better than 1,000 outside, and he would rather stand at the entrance of the Lord's house than to be seated in the tents of wickedness. And I think the idea there is basically to be right there at the opening of it. Not even being inside is better than having the full benefits, as it were, of these places where the wicked are enjoying the things that they enjoy. If we love the Lord, if we have his Spirit dwelling in us, working this gracious love in our souls, this is also what we will want, to be where the Lord reveals himself, that we may see his glory and his beauty. Now this evening, what I'd like us to consider are that there are three places that the Lord actually does reveal himself, at least three. And so three places where we, if we love the Lord, will also want to be. And I think the most obvious one is heaven, or I should say that is the ultimate one. Maybe the most obvious one is that we would be with the Lord in worship, because that's what he's actually referring to in the psalm. But the Lord is also to be found in a place that we don't often think about, and that is in the path of righteousness. If we want to walk with the Lord, we have to walk where he is. And where he is in the light, and he is where there are those who do what is right. So first of all, since we love the Lord, the place where we will ultimately want to be is with him in heaven, because it's there above every other place the Lord reveals himself. He reveals himself in all of his glory there. Now, one thing we know is that is true, and that is that God is everywhere. He's really as much here as he is anywhere else. David reminds us of that in Psalm 139, verses 7 through 10. It's also, of course, a reminder that we never do anything that the Lord isn't present to see. And the other thing is that even if he wasn't present to see it, the fact that he knows everything, he would know what we were doing anyway. But the idea is God is everywhere. He says, David says, "Where can I go from your Spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn, if I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, even there your hand will lead me, and your right hand will lay hold of me." Notice he's talking about only those places where he might feasibly go. That is David, heaven, Sheol. Sheol is not hell. Sheol is the grave. Wherever he might be in the world, but we understand that God is even, his presence is even far beyond that, in places where David never could go, which is what Solomon was expressing. As he was preparing to build the temple, he wrote to Hiram, the king of Tyre, in 2 Chronicles 3, verses 5 through 6. He says, "The house which I am about to build will be great, for greater is our God than all the gods. But who is able to build a house for him? For the heavens and the highest heavens cannot contain him. So who am I that I should build a house for him, except to burn incense before him?" He knew that temple was not going to contain God. God is infinite. He is everywhere. And that means, as I said before, that God is just as much here as he is in heaven. So what do we mean when we say it's better to be in heaven? Well, we need to recognize that it's also true that God reveals himself differently in heaven than he reveals himself here on earth, which is why it is better to be there than it is to be here. That's certainly what the Apostle Paul thought, where he writes to the Philippians in Philippians 1, verses 21 through 23. Again, a very familiar verse, or very familiar verses, and something that we should seek by God's grace to adopt within ourselves. He says, "For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which to choose. But I am hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that is very much better." Now, what is it exactly that Paul was looking at? Why is it that he thought that death for him would actually be gain rather than loss? Why did he consider it to be not just better, but very much better to leave this world and to be with him? Well, it was because of this difference in the way that the Lord reveals himself in heaven versus the way he reveals himself on earth. In heaven, God puts himself on display for all of his saints and all of his angels to see. There, he reveals himself in all of his glory, in all of his beauty, in all of his perfection. Now, there's really no way to describe what it looks like, but we can know at least this much about it. The Spirit of God, when he converted us, actually did show us the glory of the Lord, at least a glimpse of it. And that glimpse was enough to change the whole direction of our lives, so that we no longer are going towards the world because it no longer satisfies us, but now we're going toward the Lord. Now, if just a glimpse of that glory was enough to change the whole direction of our lives, how much better will it be to see the glory of the Lord in all of its fullness? Again, this is what the saints throughout the years have called the beatific vision, the beautiful vision, that sight which is more glorious than anything else. The beauty of the Lord is, you know, it's not entirely beyond our comprehension. Again, we've seen something of it, but it's more than we can really describe. It is infinite. If we like beauty, and everybody likes beauty, God's beauty is infinite. To see him is something that would be, well, the greatest blessing we could ever have. Now, God in his all of his glory is not the only thing we might say that is in heaven. Paul actually singles out someone else, although not really someone else, because, and again, here's where we get into the difference between the divinity of our Lord and his humanity. The Godhead is there revealing, as it were, themselves and all their glory, but the Lord Jesus is also there, revealed in his glory, seated at the right hand of the Father. Remember that when Jesus ascended to heaven, he didn't cast aside his human nature. It is there, it's glorified, and it's glorious to behold. He is glorious to behold. Now, we do know that Jesus, like God, is, we should say the Son of God, is in his divine nature everywhere at once, even as the Father and the Spirit are. He's just as much here as he is in heaven, but his human nature is only there. And if we want to see him, that's where we would need to be. That is what Paul wanted. He wanted to depart and to be with Christ, the one who loved him, the one who died for him. To see Jesus in all his glory, we'd have to say, is also a very large part of the joy and blessing of being in heaven. And of course, let's not forget about the Holy Spirit. He is also there revealing himself in the fullness of his love. Again, something we've only had a small taste of here that will be perfectly filled or fulfilled in his presence. When we get to heaven, we'll be so sanctified, so filled with the Spirit of God that it'll push all desire for sin out of our hearts. It'll be gone entirely. We will be able for the first time in our lives to love God and to love the Lord Jesus Christ with all of our heart and mind and soul and strength, something which we know he calls us to do on earth, but we really can't as long as we're here. We can grow in it, we can make some progress in it, but we're never going to be able to do it the way we will when we finally get to heaven. It's only in heaven that our desire is going to be fully satisfied, our desire for righteousness, for holiness, and truth. That's why Paul wanted to leave and wanted to go there, and that's why we will also want to go there as well. Now, none of us actually look forward to the way we have to get there, because the only way we can get there is through death. But even the fear of that will not stop us because of our desire to be with him. I like what Richard Baxter says when he's describing the difference between why an unconverted person might want to go to heaven and a converted person wants to go to heaven. The main thing we need to see here is that the reason why believers want to go to heaven is because God is there, because the one they love the most is there. Baxter writes this: there is a great deal of difference between the desires of heaven in a sanctified man and an unsanctified. The believer prizes it above earth and had rather be with God than here, though death that stands in the way may possibly have harder thoughts from him. But to the ungodly, there is nothing seems more desirable than this world, and therefore he only chooses heaven before hell, but not before earth, and therefore he shall not have it upon such a choice. I hope you see that Richard Baxter strongly implying here that if we really are believers, if we really love the Lord, we will choose heaven over earth. Yes, we're afraid of death. You know, death may have harder thoughts from us than heaven, certainly. But if we have a choice, we'll be like the Apostle Paul, to depart and to be with Christ is very much better. So if we love the Lord, we will want to be near him, particularly in heaven, where he reveals himself in all of his glory. But secondly, since we can't be with him right now, in heaven, our love will move us to do or to be in the second best place where he reveals himself, and that is in public worship as he calls us together to worship him on his holy day. You realize, of course, what we're doing here has, you know, unbelievers are not interested in this. They don't even see why we're here and what we're doing here. The only way we can see it, the only reason why we want to be here, is because we love the Lord. Now, as I've already told you, this is really what this psalm is all about. It is expressing the desire of the psalmist to be involved in the public worship of God. As a matter of fact, looking at the author of this psalm, we understand that this was what he was involved in. He actually had this experience. He was one of the Levites who served in the house of the Lord, and he was saying to be there and to serve the Lord in his worship on a day-to-day basis is much better than the time he was spending on the outside in the world. Well, we don't, of course, worship the Lord in a tabernacle or in a temple. We worship him, in various ways, in private worship, perhaps family worship, but particularly in the church service and the public worship which God has commanded and ordained. Now, sometimes I think we might be tempted to see the church service as something other than what it really is. Maybe is nothing more than another opportunity to hear a sermon, which we can do anywhere at any time. I mean, modern technology has made it possible for us to listen to sermons in our cars, to listen to them at home. We can watch them on television, I suppose. And we can also have the option of listening to whomever we want to listen to, right? We can tune in the celebrities, the latest and greatest and so forth. So we have that at our fingertips all the time, but we do need to understand that worship, public worship, is more than just a sermon. This may not make, if you don't understand that, this then what Martin Lloyd-Jones believed is not going to make a whole lot of sense. But those of you perhaps who know who he is, he was a great minister, used of the Lord in Great Britain, and he ministered in the 20th century. He was actually a medical doctor who was converted, gave his life to the Lord and serving him, and he became a very popular preacher. As a matter of fact, if you're familiar with the Banner of Truth, we have Lloyd-Jones to thank for that, and we also have J.I. Packer to thank for that. Now, it was said of Lloyd-Jones, notwithstanding the fact that we have these things printed and in audio recording, it was said that Martin Lloyd-Jones did not want his sermons recorded. He didn't want anybody really to listen to them. He certainly didn't want them in print, which sounds kind of strange, because he believed that after they were preached, in his opinion, they were no longer sermons. They were no longer communications from God to the congregation. That's what he saw the sermon as being. Now, I believe that he believed that his sermon still had value, and people are still benefiting from reading his sermons and listening to the audio recordings, but he did not believe that God was speaking through them any longer as he did during the service, that there was a communication during that service from God to man, because God had actually ordained the minister to stand and to preach that word. Now, that distinction is really what we're talking about here. This is a time when the Lord draws near to us. This is a time when he comes down, as it were, to meet with us. And again, he is everywhere at once, so it's not that he wasn't here before, but God reveals himself in a way that is different than we would see him on the street or in perhaps other places. He reveals himself to us that we might worship him, that we might be loved by him, sense that love, and that we might also express our love toward him. Now, that's what the psalmist is expressing here in the psalm as well. He wanted to be near to God, and he believed that God would be where the worship was actually taking place. And in New Covenant worship, which is what we're in now, it may not have all the trappings of that worship that they had. It's not as outward. It's not as ornate. Remember, the Old Covenant worship was full of types and pictures of the Lord Jesus Christ in the sacrifices, in the incense, in the showbread, in the priesthood, even in what the priests were wearing, what they would wear and how they would even change when they went to do that great sacrifice on the Day of Atonement. We don't have all of that anymore. Those pictures of the person and work of the coming Messiah, we have a worship that's based upon the fact that he's already come. We have a worship that is much more spiritual in nature, that reveals to us that we have been redeemed already, that once for all sacrifice has actually been made for us, and we have been adopted into the Lord's family. Now, even though it's not as outward, that does not mean it's any less spiritual or that God draws any less near to us here. He actually draws much nearer to us here, because here are where his redeemed people are. You know, one thing that we noted is that in the New Covenant, the Lord actually inhabits his people. They become his temple. He's no longer worshipped in temples of stone, even though this building happens to be made mainly of cinder block. You might consider that a type of stone. It's not because we're in a cinder block building that God is here or that we label this building a church. It's because the people of God are actually here. A lot of the people who worshipped him in the Old Covenant really did not even know him. There were those who did, the psalmist certainly did, but not everyone. So this worship is more spiritual. God is just as present, and he is present among his people, and he meets with us here. God speaks to us through his word, and he also speaks by his Holy Spirit who indwells us, and we respond to him here through our prayers, through our praises, and through our attention. You know, we listen to what the Lord has to say. Everything that is said from here, if it's reflecting God's word, is really God's truth, and we need to listen to it because it is. And really, our whole worship service is arranged around this interaction that we are having with God as he meets with us here. The Lord, as you know, calls us to worship him through his word. That is him calling us to worship him. We generally do this through the Psalms. And once he calls us, we respond through prayer. We ask for his presence. We ask for his blessing on our meeting. And then we have the opportunity to express our love for him through a hymn or a psalm. The Lord, again, if we're in the morning worship service, he speaks to us through his law, and that reminds us of his holy standard. Reminds us that we haven't kept that standard, but it reminds us that Jesus has, and that through his work, he gives us the power to be able also to follow him. In that example, the Spirit of God is basically working within us that grace to fulfill the law of God in us. He's making us more like Jesus. We respond to him as we think about what he commands us to do by looking to him for his mercy and his grace that he might forgive us and to give us the strength, the love, the power we need to walk with him in holiness. We then pray together and seek the Lord's mercies according to the example that Jesus gave his disciples in the Lord's Prayer, where he taught them to pray, "Our Father." And that's not something that you do when you're alone. The Lord intended us to pray together as the people of God. He speaks to us again through the reading of his word, through an explanation, an application of his word. As Paul commanded Timothy in 1 Timothy 4:13, "Until I come, give attention to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation and teaching." And then, of course, we conclude with prayer, asking the Lord to help us apply what it is that he's said. We celebrate the supper to remind us the great cost of our salvation, how much it costs God, where our source of strength actually lies, that is in the Lord Jesus Christ. We sing a closing hymn that either helps us apply what we've heard or maybe further express our love to the Lord. And then we close with his benediction, following the example of the apostles who at the end of each of their letters to the churches asked the Lord to bless them and give them the ability to live according to the truth that he has expressed in that letter. That's what the benediction is really all about. You know, one of the reasons why we have the Lord's Supper every Lord's Day is because our Lord tells us that when we celebrate it, we're actually having communion with him. Christ comes down and he communes with us. That's something of what Paul was reflecting to the Corinthians when he says in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 16, "Is not the cup of blessing which we bless a sharing in the blood of Christ? Is not the bread which we break a sharing in the body of Christ?" And I know that sounds somewhat cryptic, but the word sharing there is the Greek word koinonia, and it refers to not only sharing, but participation, fellowship, and communion. When two people have koinonia, when they have fellowship, they share in one another's gifts and graces as they, you know, spend this time together. When we participate in the Lord's table, we share in the Lord's gifts and graces. He comes down to meet us, not bodily, he's not here physically, but he is here spiritually. And that's something that we really cannot enjoy if we're not actually present. And we can't enjoy the other things that the Lord gives to us if we don't meet with him in worship in this way. Now, the fact that the Lord meets with us in worship is one of the reasons why he commands us, actually through the author to the Hebrews, not to abstain from coming to worship. He says through the author to the Hebrews, as I've mentioned, Hebrews 10, verses 23 through 25, "Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." By the way, that's what's behind the fourth commandment, the reason why the Lord wants us to keep the Sabbath day holy. He gave us this day so that we might be free from other obligations and devote ourselves to worshiping him. It's a day of rest and a day of worship. And so if we love him, of course, we'll want to be near him, but we need to draw near to him where he is. And where he is particularly in heaven, but he is also in his worship services that he has ordained for that very purpose. Now, finally, what do we do between the times that we meet together for worship? Because that's basically only one day in seven, right? We meet together on Sunday. What do we do on the other 6 days if we want to draw near to God, if we want to walk with God? Well, if we want to walk with him, we do need to walk where he is. We'll only find him in the path where he's walking, and the only place where we can be sure to find him is in the path, John tells us, of truth and righteousness. Listen to what he writes in 1 John 1, verses 5 through 7. This is the message we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Now, what is John telling us here? Well, he's telling us, first of all, that we're not going to have fellowship with God, which is what we want. We want fellowship with him. We want to be near him. We're not going to have it if we walk in the darkness, if we walk in ignorance, if we walk in a lie, if we walk in the path of sin. Now, what he's talking about here is the same thing that we've already seen Paul telling us, which is, if we sow to the flesh, we will from the flesh reap corruption. And one of the reasons we will reap corruption is because when we walk in the path of sin, which is what it means to sow to the flesh, we will grieve and quench and drive away the Holy Spirit, which ends in greater corruption for us, because less of the Spirit means the flesh gets stronger. Now, thankfully, as Christians, we can't drive the Spirit of God altogether away. We don't want to do that, and we never can. And I think David, even expressing in Psalm 51, where he says, "The Lord, don't take your Holy Spirit away from me," I don't think he understands that as absolutely, because the believer cannot absolutely lose the Spirit. But when we sin, we do lose the influence of the Holy Spirit, which is what makes us, again, experience more corruption. If we want to fellowship with the Lord, we have to avoid that path and instead walk in the light, walk in the path of truth, walk in the path of righteousness. We need to sow to the Spirit, as we saw before. We need to seek the Lord, as we talked about this morning, through the Word, through prayer, through the table, in fellowship. We need to serve our neighbor and our brothers and sisters in the Lord, as we saw that's also what it means to sow in the Spirit. And if we do these things, we will be walking with Christ. We will be near him. Remind you of what Jesus said in the Great Commission, which can be seen as a summary of basically everything that he wants us to do. If we will follow him, if we will submit to the work he wants to do through us, to our neighbor and to our brethren and in our worship of the Lord, he says he will be with us. Remember the promise attached to the Great Commission? I am with you always, even to the end of the age. If you want to be near the Lord, you have to walk where he's walking. Well, he's walking in the path he wants you to walk in. That's where you need to catch up to him. If you're in the other path, you're not going to find him there. If you love him and you want to be near him, you need to walk where he's going. So love will make us want to draw near to the Lord. Love will make us want to be in heaven. Love will make us want to be gathered with the people of God in public worship, because here the Lord draws near to us, and love will also make us want to fellowship with the Lord in the path of obedience. Again, think about what the psalmist says in Psalm 84, 5. How blessed is the man whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. How blessed, because they love the Lord, and it's going to move them in the right directions, and they will find him. Again, Watson reminds us, love heaven, love God. And you cannot miss it. You cannot miss being in heaven, because if you love the Lord, it will break through all opposition, everything that stands in the way. It will give you the grace to take heaven by storm. So may the Lord grant us the grace to love him with an undivided heart, as we saw this morning, and to do, as it were, to love everyone else as the byproduct of our love for him, so that he would be first and foremost always. That is what will give us the strength we need to do what the Lord calls us to do. Well, let's take a moment and bow in silent prayer, and let's ask the Lord to help us do that.